Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, and co-parents of all ages, this podcast is for you. Introducing in the center ring, the amicable divorce expert, Judith Weigel.
When I was with the circus, we kept some acts from year to year, and we switched out acts too. We had animal acts, acrobatic acts, thrill acts, and comedy acts. But within each act type, even if we replaced one flying trapeze act, for instance, with another, the performers all brought something a little different to their act, making them their own unique entity within that act type. And then, of course, you all remember the Big Apple Circus and Cirque du Soleil. Well, they actually redefined circus in America. So too with our guest today, Cindy Stibbert, a divorce career and life transitional coach with her own unique approach to this work. Her company is called Divorce Redefined. Cindy, thank you for joining us today.
Thank you, Judith. It's an honor to be here with you today.
Well, this is going to be a great conversation. And just to start it off, would you just share with our listeners a little bit of your backstory leading to your work now?
Yes. So I think a little bit as a divorce coach, it almost speaks for itself as to what possibly would have inspired me to go down this path. So yes, it was my own divorce. And I realized that going through divorce is, of course, like everyone going through it, it's entirely traumatizing on an emotional level, on a social level, on a financial level, on a personal level, and on a family level. And going through the process myself really opened my eyes to the fact that so many people are going down this path feeling unsupported, feeling alone, feeling like they really don't know how to navigate this very scary transition in their life. And so we tend to go down the path of making all those big mistakes, hiring that lawyer that's going to cost you a fortune, ending up in court in a place that potentially you never wanted to be in the first place. And all of it stems from just not knowing your options and not doing enough research to know that there are so many different ways to support a divorce that doesn't have to be that antiquated system. So while I was going through my process, I was learning some big lessons the hard way by spending too much money out of the gates and by causing an adversarial situation, which I had to start to turn around for myself, where there was no way I was going to be able to afford my divorce. And also in the process, I had a lot of other women reach out to me confidentially, asking me questions about my process or asking for advice and not realizing that so many other people are going down this path. How can we support them in a better way? And so it really inspired me to go and do some training. I had my certified divorce coach certification. I am also a certified divorce specialist through the National Association of Divorce Professionals. And then I am a chartered career coach, because not only was I going down the path of divorce, I was a stay-at-home mom for 11 years. I was a teacher before, and I was a dinosaur now in that field. What was I going to do to support myself? So all of those steps in that life experience really inspired me to want to help others who are struggling with just the same type of thing, because you're not alone. As much as you feel like you are in that moment, you really are not alone.
Well, you know, it's an interesting dichotomy, because you're not alone. There are people that can support you, share experiences with you, help you in a very positive way. But you are alone in your individuation, in yes. your individual experience. What do you have to make right in your life? How do you have to redirect your life to not mm-hmm. only get through now, but to have a look towards the future? So you made a very revealing statement as you were giving your backstory, and that was saying you were saying that you added to the controversy a little bit and then had to back mm-hmm. off and change. Can you, do you mind sharing a little bit of that?
Absolutely. I think that a lot of us go in with good intentions, but because we choose a lawyer and a lawyer maybe has a specific style or a certain direction, they're trained to do divorce a certain way. And so because we also don't really understand the process and we don't feel like we can have a voice in this, that we have to be led by the lawyers, we can lose control of that process. And I was noticing that that was happening for me. And I was going down a path I did not want to go down. And the more back and forth was happening with me and the lawyer, the worse my situation was becoming. And I was, the more money I was spending in the process. So I had to start to separate, you know, my emotional state, because a lot of it was emotionally driven, which I think can sometimes be part of the whole process, to start to think about, okay, this is, what are some rational, realistic choices that I need to make? Because I think first and foremost, we get so caught in the unraveling of our emotions that we're looking at the now instead of, divorce is a long game. We have to think about what this is going to look like 5, 10, 15 years from now. And those decisions that we make right now are going to affect our future and the future of our kids.
Absolutely. And you embodied in what you said are a couple really interesting concepts that I talk about a lot and therapists talk about a lot. And that is, there are two divorces. There's the emotional divorce and there's the legal divorce. The emotional divorce is, as you described it, you literally have to sort out all of these emotions from fear, abandonment, mm-hmm. What's the future going to hold? Am I going to make it? How am I going to be perceived? Who do I want to be? All that stuff, right? But it's mm-hmm. a lot of hurt and grief and sorrow, anger. Forgiveness has to come in somewhere or you'll become sick forever. And then there's the legal divorce. And the legal divorce is what everybody obviously knows. You file, there's paperwork, there's professionals, there's at least lawyers for legal advice. If nothing else, you do need legal advice. Mm-hmm. But to make those legal decisions, and I want you to speak to this, to make those legal decisions while you're emotional, what good comes from that?
Oh yeah, 100%. And I think that we can't make any really rational decisions when our brain isn't rationally working. You know, I always say to my clients, you're hiring me to rent my rational brain when yours isn't working. I like that you pointed out that there are two different divorces, but I actually see it more as four different divorces. I think that one, it's your emotional divorce. Two, it's the social divorce, because the impact of the people around you is pretty significant. And a lot of us don't expect that. Even our closest friends can really struggle with something like this and not knowing how to support you. And our world is set up to be coupled. So now that you're single, it poses a whole nother challenge of being part of those social groups. And, you know, typically, unfortunately, people become polarized. They either choose one side or the other, and they often choose the person who was left, even if, you know, a lot of that spurred the reason why their partner had left the marriage. So those are the first two for me, emotional, social. Then you have the financial divorce. That piece can also be really in the way of finalizing the legal part of the divorce, because it's the numbers are a huge fear for a lot of people, which also keeps people in a marriage that they're unhappy with because they're scared of what that financial piece of their future looks like. So to me, anyways, there's four. And I think that as you heal each one, then you can finally get to that legal divorce and create an outcome that's final.
Yeah, no, I couldn't agree with you more. That was so well said. And yes, you're absolutely right. There's the social and the financial divorce. And within the social, I had a woman on the show a couple times, Nikki Bruno. She was talking about her divorce, two children. You have children. So many people do. She was quite surprised at the couples that became her and her husband's friends due to that connection of the kids going to school, mm-hmm. same school, or if not the same school, you live in the same neighborhood. And so your social circle is centered around your children. And you're right. The friends do feel awkward. They don't know what to do. They almost don't want to render advice. Do you think, what was your experience with couple friends of you and your ex-husband?
Yeah, I think it was tricky. It's tricky to navigate. For us, we were lucky to have a lot of long-term friends, you know, like we're talking 20 years. And so those friends, that small group, but those friends really saw the duration of our marriage. And so it's hard to hide your struggles when you're close to people for that long. So I think those long-term friends were the ones that were able to say, okay, you know what? We got here, we could see how this happened from both sides, and we're going to try to be as Switzerland as possible for both of you. I mean, realistically, does it happen all the time? Not necessarily. It's hard to kind of figure out, well, which side do we have for dinner when, you know, when they're apart. And so it comes to be revolved around the kids. So we were lucky to have a group of friends who were very mature about it. But I found that a lot of our newer type friends, you know, really stepped back, and a lot of judgment and almost projection of people's fear can really show up in a divorce process. You know, the friends that you thought really had your back might not in a time like this, because they aren't sure. You know, your friendship doesn't have that longevity of they've seen you through all of these different phases, and now it's a bit threatening. And I've done some research and some work with women around why their friendships change. And typically they find that women particularly are a bit more of a threat spending time with their coupled friends. You know, now it looks like, oh God, is divorce contagious? You know, is my wife going to leave me because, you know, her best friend is divorced? Or now is she a threat to my marriage potentially? You know, how do we handle this single woman in our lives? And so that can be challenging for some couples for sure. Men, on the other hand, don't seem to have that for some reason. I don't know. And they couple a lot quicker after divorce than women do sometimes. Just to kind of re-get themselves back, I guess, into that social status place. And I think friends can be really challenging. And I think it's always good to be mindful that this is also a bit of their divorce, being the social divorce, because they're having to grieve the loss of you guys as a couple. You know, maybe you were that family that they traveled with and went on vacations with their kids with, and now they don't have that anymore. So they're grieving the loss of what they had with you too.
That is so important, and that has not been brought up yet with any of my other guests. And I'm sure everybody's experienced this, but that's a real life example that couples, families have other families as friends, and if they have more than one house, there's a summer house, they go to that, they do other things together. All of that stops. Yes, I didn't think about that. But I think you bring up another good point and for the female listeners to this show. And that is, I think women are feared. As a single woman, oh my gosh, well, there's no barriers. So what if she's interested in my husband? Those playful little flirtatious interchanges that they used to have when we were watching the football game together with a bunch of people in the house are now looked at differently because you don't have your husband to frame these flirtations as perfectly innocent, right?
Mm. Yeah, I think that it definitely is a different perspective for sure. And it's just something to be mindful, you know, if you're going through that process and you notice that your friends do change. And a lot of times too, when friends are struggling in their marriages, those are the ones that are going to back up first, because it's like looking in a mirror, right? Oh God, like this is actually reality coming true for her. This is my situation. Is this my reality? And so what I noticed in my situation is a lot of those people just couldn't handle that facing the potential that their marriage was struggling too. And it's easier to look at someone else struggle, right, than to look at your own situation, which is also heartbreaking because you think a lot of these people, a lot of marriages struggle and a lot of them are going through difficult times, yet we are too afraid of the stigma attached to go deeper into that and figure out how to find out support. And the idea of even the word divorce, you know, really, really terrifies people. And I think a lot can be done to try to reduce that stigma around that, even that word divorce.
Yes, but also, again, piggybacking off of what you said, we can redefine how married people respond to the couple divorcing, not to fear, but to learn. If we can turn fear into learning, okay, so they're getting divorced, if they will share the reasons why without going into the dirty laundry, but if they can share the struggle, we can learn, we the people who have not yet filed for divorce, we can learn and maybe prevent the divorce if it's preventable in our marriage. And I think at some points it is, until you've been married so long, it's just like, okay, we have really enjoyed a 20, 25 year experience. Maybe we have another experience waiting for us, and that's not horrible. But redefining, since you are divorced, redefined, that situation can be redefined. Do you agree, or do you think I'm reaching?
Oh, no, I think you're spot on. And the reason that I really called my practice divorce redefined, because I think that we really do need to redefine what divorce means. It's not the failure of a marriage. You know, your marriage was successful for the time that it was together, whether it was together for 2 years or 25 years, it was successful for that period of time. Because it ended doesn't mean that it failed. You know, a lot of things end, the life cycle ends, and it just allows a chance to grow something new. And I think because we look at divorce as such a sad and traumatic experience, it might be for one side of the couple, but maybe for the other side, this is an opportunity for regrowth, rebuilding. This is not sad for them. This is a relief. This is a chance to start fresh. This is something totally, totally different for them. And I think it's a chance for us to look at deeper at our marriages and think, how can we, yes, prevent this path from happening? Or let's talk about it. You know, I've been unhappy. You've been unhappy. What do we think of that? Is this something that we want to work on so that we can continue to last for a long time? Or, you know, is our contract expired? Have you taken this as far as it goes and you are no longer really gaining a lot from each other, but you're there because, well, you married into it and it's become a habitual part of your life. I think a lot of us don't actualize our true happiness because we figure that we've gotten ourselves into this place. And whether it be marriage, I'm not saying that everyone, you know, oh, let's just divorce all over the place. But it's a great chance to look deeper. And is this relationship serving you? And if it's not, how can you work together to make it so? Because it does take both of you. You know, one person cannot do all the work to keep a marriage together.
Absolutely, without a doubt. Could you explain the concept that you introduced, divorce is a long game? What do you mean?
Yeah, so I think divorce, it's a marathon, really. You know, it's not a sprint. I think that a lot of times people want it done. They get into the situation, they just want to get it over with, so they give up too soon, or they throw in the towel, or they give away the farm. You know, they give away too much. And the decisions that you make in this moment that are typically made based on heightened emotion are really important that they're thoughtful and that they're rational and that they really consider your future. Because let's just say you were a woman in a situation and you really felt like you're bulldozed, you didn't have a voice in your marriage. So you decided to not pursue as much spousal or child support as you could have. That is going to affect your financial future. In a way that may have caused you to have to work, until you're 70 years old on a financial level, which there's nothing wrong with that. I've now gone into a sole second career of my life and I don't want to retire. You know, I've got till 70, I'm sure, because I love what I do. But having made those choices, not really understanding the future impact is really huge. But there are people, professionals you can bring into your divorce process to help create clarity on that picture. And this person specifically, I would say, is a certified divorce financial advisor, because it's usually the long numbers game that you want to look at in terms of how much is this money going to last me. Great, you want to go for your lawyer wants to go for a specific number in terms of your settlement, but what does that look like 10, 15 years from now? Is that going to be enough to sustain you or your children? And if it's going to last for 10 years, great. How are you going to then supplement that at the 10-year mark? And I think also when we say divorce is a long game, you are never going to be officially free from your ex-spouse if you have children together. So how are you going to then really change this from your intimate relationship into a business parenting relationship with this person and sustain that? Because unfortunately, when it comes to the legal divorce part, you sign the papers and, you know, it's like you're done. But it doesn't end there. It continues to go on for years and years after, because you have to engage and you have to learn how to communicate with each other, and you still have to protect and raise these kids together. So what does that look like?
Right. And go to the kids' college graduations and marriages and baptisms, mm-hmm. and grandchildren and all of that. Absolutely. I like that you brought up the financial piece as part of the long game, because all too many times when there's a power imbalance and you get to the mediation table or the settlement conference table and you're working out the numbers, you're right. Anybody sitting at that table other than the two spouses, once it's over, they move on. But you live with these decisions. So it is important to take the time you need to flesh out your financial life. And also, I think, to choose people on the team, and I want you to put the team together that you think is right in a second for people. But when you're with your team, shouldn't we choose a team that can look at your long game and make sure you don't come back to them and say, why didn't you stop and make me think through this a little longer? Don't we need that? Maybe we don't even say it, but aren't we choosing people that we think are dotting our I's and crossing our T's for us?
Yes. Oh, 100%. And there isn't one person in the divorce process that can do every single component of it successfully from beginning to end. You know, your lawyer does not have the financial background typically. They don't have the parenting background typically. They don't have the emotional training. They have the legal part, and we get so caught up with our rights legally that we don't put as much importance and emphasis on the financial piece, the emotional piece, the co-parenting piece. And instead of creating this divide, when I say divorce is a team-based thing, I feel like traditionally we each go to a lawyer and there's this divide. But you're really trying to maintain or establish a relationship with your ex-spouse so that you can both get through this divorce in a relatively rational and thoughtful way. I mean, it's going to affect both of you in the long game. So for me, my vision as to how this experience of divorce changes would be to start right out of the gates with a divorce coach. You know, someone like myself is there to help guide them through the process in terms of, okay, what are your options, first of all? What are your intentions in this? What do you want this to look like 5-10 years from now? Let's bring those intentions into the process so that we can make the best choices. Then let's take a look at the financial piece and bring in a certified divorce financial advisor. This person was a game changer for me in my divorce, because up until then, you're really just it's hearsay what your numbers are until you get them on the table and you know black and white. You're just kind of playing with randomness. And a lot of emotion is attached to those random numbers. Until you get them on the table, you can then start to be creative with how is this going to be shared. And then I would love to see couples transition into, you know, a guided mediation in a way. I know that each side does need to have legal representation, that is their right, but to be able to look at a picture instead of we're dividing everything down the middle, you know, take a look at it as we have an orange, and instead of dividing it in half because I want to make juice with it and you want the peel to bake a cake, why can't we look at how we can use this orange so that we both get what we want? Because if we just divided everything down the middle, we might, neither of us might actually get what we want. We just got half of everything, but that might not exactly be beneficial to us. So I think there's so much opportunity in being creative and having a mediator work with both parties and separately can really sort of establish what is this, what our wants and needs are in this, and how can we communicate those in the best way so that you can create your future. It's not a cookie cutter situation. I know there's lots of cookie cutter templates for parenting plans and separation agreements, and yeah, that exists. But what does this divorce mean to you? What do you want this to look like for your family?
Yeah, no, it starts with templates. It starts with some cookie cutter things because you have to start somewhere. And then, okay, that's great. Well, let's put this aside. Now, what are our needs as a family going forward, only in two houses? What are our needs individually? So yeah, definitely well said. Mm-hmm. One of the unique things, other than the way you're expressing yourself, which I'm loving, but the other unique thing redefined here, in terms of coaching, I look at you as a coach redefined now. Not only do I know that you take care of people throughout the divorce process, but you offer something that I've not seen before, and that is the career counseling, the approach to life after divorce, and actually thinking about that when you're thinking about the financial piece in the divorce, kind of piggybacking off of that, and how do I want to be defined professionally if you do want to work, if you need to work, which generally we do. So talk about that. You added that piece. So Cindy, you are, mm-hmm. and I said it before, you're a certified divorce and career coach, right?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Why did you choose the career coach part to complement the divorce part?
I thought that it was very fitting to the whole process of how do we recover and get back on our feet after divorce. I feel like I said earlier, we sign on that paper and then we're out the door and it's over. But our life isn't over. So how do we create a supported system where we can then redefine who we are in our next chapter? Because it isn't going to be exactly the same as you were in your first chapter of your life. And this is an opportunity for us to grow, find a passion. And for a lot of clients so far that have been mine, women need to go back into that workforce. And if you've been at home, like I was for 11 years with my kids, I was terrified. I didn't have a resume written. I had no idea what I was going to do with myself. I was a teacher for 20 years before that, and I could have gone back to the classroom. But even that, the technology that was involved in that profession alone had changed dramatically since I'd been there. And now I had some skills I needed to catch up on, because it wasn't going to just be that easy to fall right back into that position. So it was a chance for me to think about what is it that I want to do next in my life. And so for me going into the career coaching, I realized how terrifying that whole process even is. You feel like you've been out of touch for so long. You know, I didn't even know how to make a LinkedIn profile at the time of my divorce, you know, and how do I leverage my connections? Who do I talk to? Like, this is terrifying. So in order to be able to move through your life in a really supported, empowered way, my career coaching certification really helps to support those people reinventing themselves, redefining who they are, not being defined by their divorce, but being defined by something that they find passionate. And sometimes it's about just renewing those skills, finding that those skills and strategies that helps them feel more confident about getting back in the workforce. So I help them write a resume, write cover letters, create a LinkedIn profile, start the connection process so they can really feel confident, get them ready for a job interview. What does that look like? You know, how do I follow up? And then how do I negotiate for myself when I do get a job offer? And it comes with just rebuilding that confidence and that identity of who you are and who you want to be in your next life. Because I had to do that myself. And I thought that if I could help people do the same thing in a really supported way, this is going to provide them for such a better future. And not only that, it's such an awesome role model for their kids to be able to see, you know, mom or dad is getting themselves back out there and really a chance to redefine who they are. And in the process, it's super empowering and inspiring. And I've never been happier with my life than I have in the past 3.5 years because of following my passion and really living into my life value and figuring out what that is.
What is your process when you're helping people launch a new career and re-enter the workforce? Because just that alone is a stumbling block. Well, I don't know what to do. I don't know what's out there in the world for me to do. How do you go through that process with people so they can get in touch with decisions that are right for them?
Mm-hmm. Well, we do a process of, it's about 6 weeks, my program. And at the beginning, we really start to do a self-discovery. You know, what really lights your fire? What is really makes you passionate? What is makes you excited? Is there something in your life that you love spending time doing that makes you feel alive? And how does that support your identity? And what are your life values? And are those supporting your life values? And then taking a look at the world, who's already doing potential things that you feel inspired by? Who out there already has roles that you would think were your dream jobs? If you could have any job, what would that would look like? And what is required to get there? I think a lot of us get so held back because we think, oh, well, I don't have the skills for that. Or I'm not an entrepreneur, so I could never do that. Or I have to go back and get my business degree. There are so many skills that you already have at this stage in your life. You know, the process of even going through the conflict of divorce, for one, brings in so many different skills. You can put that on your resume, you know, to make you stronger in how you've managed this. And I think our life experience, we underestimate how many different skills we can actually bring to the table. So I really work with clients uncovering what those are, really taking a look at what they have offered their life, raising kids, what they've brought to the table, the value that they've provided even in their marriage, and how those can translate into an opportunity for work. So finding really that self-expression, you know, what really excites me. I know I might not want to go back and, you know, be a Starbucks barista. You don't have to be that. You could be something completely different. It's finding that and then learning the process of how do I make that happen.
My sister-in-law, Cindy, did something that I loved, and I talk about this all the time. She is not divorced, by the way, but she had, well, two children, one out of college, one in college right now. But when they were little, she left her job at Mac, where she was on her way to upper-level management, because my brother did well enough that they could have the traditional model of just let him work, and she can raise the kids, because he liked that idea of mom being at home and was very supportive of that. So it apparently worked for them because one's out of college, one is in college. But she got a business card for herself. And the business card said professional mom. And it listed the things she did as a mom. Education, culinary. I mean, break down everything a mom does, especially if it's the mom that keeps the books, the financial books, the checking and savings accounts for the house, is on top of all the school decisions. Honey, you just come. Here's our parent-teacher conference. The kids have a program on such and such a day. Here, I marked it on your calendar. Whatever. It is management.
Absolutely. It's absolutely management on an executive level. You have all of these different things to be taking care of, troubleshooting, conflict resolution. It is definitely a level of management that is so underestimated, and it's taken for granted, all those skills that are required, which, by the way, as a mother, we never got training for. So it was all on the job learning at the time.
That's right. That's absolutely right. And I think that if women put on their resumes a professional mom for X number of years on their resumes, their true employer is the one that respects that, the one that gives you a positive reaction. That's a potential employer. If somebody, you know, makes a face, passive aggressive, doesn't run screaming, you do not want to work in this environment, because I don't understand how anybody in this day and age cannot understand the work of a mom, especially coming out of the pandemic, when both partners had to be at home working. And now the one who wasn't at home typically is watching this unfold. And how can you not understand how difficult it is to run a household with children?
It really, really is. And until they have to get into that position themselves, do they start to understand? I think, even speaking from my personal experience, my ex-husband had several actually in the first year to 2 years after we were divorced, because I was 98% mom and went 50-50 shared parenting. So that was a huge learning curve for him, which I think was great. You know, he really had to step up to the plate. And I think as a mom staying home with my kids, I took control of that. You know, that was me. My home was my office. My home was sort of where I did my business, and I was the CEO of the house. And so giving half of that responsibility, first of all, was very difficult. You know, it would be like me walking into his office and saying, okay, we share a desk now and you can go home half the days. You know, it's not that easy to let that go. But it was a great opportunity for him and my kids to learn, okay, how is dad as a parent? You know, we as moms don't often give them the chance because they're off working, and our role, which we've chosen or not, or it's an agreed upon role when you have kids, is to be that home mom. And I think if we can somehow establish a bit more balance in our current marriages and families now, there will be less stress and onus on the mother. I see a lot of successful couples, and part of that success is that both of them are contributing to that household. And a lot of times, both of them are also contributing on a financial level. One could be more than the other, for sure, but there is that balance attached because both parents have to step up to the plate. They don't have another option. They have to both be equally involved in this parenting. And only then do you really understand and respect the difficult journey and the difficult job that is.
Yeah. And I think it's important not only for the parent who's not been at home, growing in that level of appreciation can only make you a better parent, without a doubt. And then the respect that you give to the stay-at-home parent, I think it's beneficial to both ex-spouses and certainly beneficial to the children. Cindy, I want people to understand that you can either go through a divorce and say, hey, I can be a coach, and then buy a business card, put a website together, you can be a coach. But that's not what you did. You actually went to school. You actually earned certificates. You went through programs. Please talk about that a little bit. It shows, by the way, as you speak, but I'd like people to know how highly credentialed you are.
Oh, well, thank you. I think it's very important. I mean, I also was a teacher. I have a Bachelor of Arts and a Bachelor of Education. And so I think I have a bit of lifelong learning in me. And I also think there's a lot of credibility and respect that comes with having qualifications. I think the world of coaching can be very open right now. And so anyone can be a coach. But I think that just because you've had a life experience doesn't make you an expert. And just because I went through divorce doesn't make me an expert on divorce, because every divorce although the process is similar, everyone's divorce story is so unique and so unique to them that what worked for me may not work for everybody else. And I needed to be able to do some training so that I could understand how to best guide people through their own process without bringing my process into their process. And knowing some of a little bit of the ins and outs of the law, knowing a bit of the ins and outs of the real estate world, knowing a bit of the ins and outs of the finances. You know, I don't offer advice at those levels, but my certification really broadened my knowledge of what are the things to consider during a divorce, because there were a lot of things I didn't consider during my divorce. And to be able to provide my clients with accurate information with the right education so that they can make the best informed decisions, to me, that's really important. And I always feel that if I'm not, I need to be strong enough for my clients in my own knowledge base so that I can expect them to make the right choices. And I never want that to fall back on me because I didn't know enough. So I'd rather go and do the work so that I can be the best coach that I can be for anyone who comes to me, knowing that I've done the training, I've done the work, I've made the connections with people, you're in the right place, you can trust me. I've got, you know, the background to show it. And it's not just based on my own life experience, although that helps too.
No, you're absolutely right. You know, I learned years ago that when I got into mediation, which by the way, you don't have to have a license for either. It is this wild west of careers. And A, you're either good at being able to navigate a conversation between people so that they can come to settlements. But if you don't know the law in your particular area of mediation, and this is where I harp on this and I become defensive even sometimes. If you don't know the law in your particular area of mediation, you can't possibly serve your clients. And it's mm-hmm. not to quote the law. So you aptly said, no, I'm not going to be your financial expert. I'm not going to be your legal expert. But I at least know that there are, you break down the areas of a divorce that need to be addressed by individual professionals. And that's mm-hmm. what I say in mediation. Okay, great, you have a good personality to mediate. Maybe you've been part of a mediation. Do you know the law surrounding what you want to mediate? Because if you don't, and you allow people to start making decisions that the court won't support, once that settlement agreement goes to court, they're going to look at you and say, well, what did we spend that time and money for if you didn't know that it was going to be rejected? And it's so hard to get people to understand that. And it may seem self-serving, which it is, but I spent time and money educating myself and getting mini certificates. You know, there's no state mm-hmm. license, but there are certifications. Mm-hmm. And I spend time and money, and I want people to do that as well. I think it's important, and it really shows in your area. And here's where it seriously shows. So first of all, Cindy has a great website, everybody. And we're going to give you that information before we end the episode. We still have a little bit more to go. But when I went through the website to learn as much about you as I could, I noticed you had something that I had not seen yet, and it was wonderful. You had checklists. You had three areas of checklists for people to consider. You have the considering divorce checklist to really have you think about how this is going to impact you. You have the life, You have the life after divorce checklist. You have navigating the divorce checklist. And you have a third one. Is it considering divorce? Okay, I said that right, right? Mm-hmm. What you have three checklists. I said considering the divorce, navigating the divorce, and life after the divorce.
Yes.
Why did you put those checklists? This is brilliant.
I think for me, it's because my role is to really meet an individual right where they are in the process. I think that right from the very beginning, when you're even contemplating the idea of divorce, I see so many people say, oh, I'm not ready to make that decision. And I'm not ready to talk to someone like you because I haven't made the decision. That's exactly when you want to talk to somebody about this, because you want to get as much information as possible so that you can make that decision. And if you did make that decision, you're basing it based on actually done my research. I've gotten information and education about the path of divorce, and I am prepared to make the decision. We cannot go blind into this. You know, I think that a lot of people wait until they're sure. We don't often know anything for sure unless we've done some work around it to figure out whether or not this is for us. So starting right there, that's where a great step would be for people, even if they haven't made the leap, but are even toying with the idea. Then secondly, navigating the process. I mean, what is the landscape of divorce? What does it look like can I expect from this process? Who are the people that are going to be involved in it? What can I expect from them? How can I be connected to those people that I know have my best interests at heart? So my job is to help them navigate those turbulent waters and connect them with people that really will support them and resonate on a value level with them. I've personally vetted every single person that I will refer my clients to, because I never feel comfortable just referring out if I have not had a conversation like this and we have established that our perspectives are very similar and that there's a referral partnership developing. I need to feel confident that whoever I send my clients to, they're going to be well taken care of. And then post-divorce, you know, this, like we said, is a long game. Just because you get divorced and you sign on that dotted line does not mean things are over. So what does that mean for you next? How do you recover and redefine yourself? How do you co-parent now, potentially with a very difficult person? What does that look like? So I work on communication skills with my clients. How do you communicate so that you are not continually stoking this adversarial fire for years to come? And then how do you want your life to look on a career perspective, on an individual perspective, and learning from this whole process to make you a redefined version of who you are at the end?
So I want to go to the navigating the divorce process. I went through all of this and I highlighted a few things. The first thing I highlighted was managing tough emotions, triggers, and hot buttons that arise and impede and block the process. Mm-hmm. Is that where your communication coaching comes in? How do you work with this? Because this is, as far as I'm concerned, king. If you can deal with this, you can minimize as much aggression as humanly possible.
Absolutely. And because divorce is so emotionally charged, we make decisions based on those emotions. But where is that coming from? I see a lot of people that I work with, they either get stuck on a certain element. Let's say it's, I want to keep the family home. Even though realistically that may not be the best option for them or a financial option, but emotionally they're stuck on this idea, I need to have that house. So I work with my clients around, okay, well, what does that mean for you? Why is that home so important? What would be a second option to create for you? What would a different option look like if you were to have one that didn't involve the home? Let's think creatively and look at what are those hooking triggers that make them feel that they need to have this house. Is it fear that they don't want to live somewhere new because it's an adjustment? Is it fear that they don't want to live in an apartment because they've done so much for this house and this house is a representation of who they are? Is it that it's going to be smaller and that you're worried that you won't have any place for the kids? You know, are you just overwhelmed by the whole thought of moving, you know, and uprooting everybody? You know, where is this coming from? So working on unhooking those, because those can really get in the way with making rational decisions. And also looking at parenting. You know, I've seen when you're really starting to negotiate parenting time with the kids, you can really get stuck on, well, I need to have the kids for this many days and I don't want to share the kids because of A, B, C, D. Where when you're in a marriage, you wouldn't even probably question whether or not you're sharing your kids with your spouse. You know, you just would, and you'd welcome the opportunity to have a night off, let's say. So where is this coming from where you need to have that control or you need to have a bit more time? And why do you need that more time? And how is it impacting the kids? So looking at all of those sort of underlying triggers and creating more of a realistic mindset of how do I look at this from all the different angles?
Yeah, you hit my second thing, thinking and communicating from a place of rationality and dignity rather than from heightened emotion. It's super important. And you brought up one of the best examples, the house, first of all. It is typically the biggest asset people have, typically, if you're not underwater and, you know, if you're in an area where housing prices have gone up, which I think is everywhere in the United States now. It does become this horrible block. And I was sitting in a mediation recently where the house was valued at 1.7. Easy to value that in Los Angeles, by the way. Mm-hmm. And the offer from the other spouse said, well, I know you can't buy me out right now. And they were negotiating how the buyout was going to be, but I think you undervalued the house. I think it's 2.2, and I'd like to offer that to you right now. Well, I just fell off my chair. I'm like, yes. And she said no. And I'm like, oh my God, how do you say no? And take it now. Mm-hmm. And it was a fishing game. But that's where you get so blocked that that house is your life. Well, you know what? Mm-hmm. It's a house. I get the emotional attachment to a home because you fix it up. It's your castle. It's where you go every day. It's your safe space. It's where your children grew up. Completely get the emotional attachment. But what if there was a horrifying weather condition? Like, we have fires constantly in Los Angeles that ruin homes. Well, okay, now everything you just wanted to preserve went up in smoke. You're going to go on. You actually are going to live past this, get another home, and you're going to be happy again. And so using that dramatic example, I would like to encourage people, don't get stuck on the house. Mm-hmm. If you can make more money, if you can be in a better this is where rationality comes in. If you can be in a better position financially by selling the house, even though you may be giving up some of those memories, the memories are in your head. Mm-hmm. You will never lose those memories. You've taken pictures. Yeah, you have exactly. Those memories, but now you have a financial start. Mm-hmm. You could probably buy another beautiful house, newer, less improvements. Who knows? Yes.
And the emotional attachment that comes with staying in that home. I mean, that's a constant reminder of what is now your old life. So if you want to start fresh or you want to start a new relationship, you may want to just, you know, clean that slate a bit and create an environment. A lot of emotional triggers and memories come from the environment that we're in. So in order to really start that again, your environment needs to change. And so part of that is where people get stuck.
Cindy, such a good point. Such a good point. I forgot about that your old life is still in front of you in that house. And there always will be trigger points that bring you back to your marriage somehow, emotional trigger points. You can't get away from it.
That's right.
So I have to remember this in mediations. Thank you for that. lastly, on that checklist of navigating the divorce process, I underscored setting reasonable and fair goals for your settlement by encouraging compassion, empathy, cooperation, and amicable, productive, or parallel co-parenting for the long term. You just put all of these wonderful emotional components inside of making rational, reasonable, and fair goals. Mm-hmm. How did you get to that? That was brilliant. That was
great. Yeah, it takes a lot of work to be able to find compassion and empathy during something like this, because we are taught through the adversarial process that it's all about winning. You know, we all want to just win in the divorce process. And it really isn't about that. You both want to come out as winners at the end of the day because you're both going to parent your children. How would you possibly want the other person to be emotionally and financially devastated when they are now having to co-parent your children with you for the rest of your life? There may be limits. There's going to be a bit of a different situation on, you know, how much maybe the assets are divided. But in order to know where each of us are hooked, it's important to take a look at what that might mean for the other person. in my situation, my ex-spouse was very hooked on money. You know, he really wanted to hold on to that money. So for me, in order to find compassion, I need to understand that this was important value for him. For my value was the kids. So maybe if he wanted to hold on to his money a bit more, then there was more flexibility for me with the kids, depending on, you know, what worked for both of us. And also looking at, knowing that that was a huge trigger point for him, I needed to look at the financial picture really clearly with my divorce advisor, because I needed to know where was the line between, okay, this is enough. I could continue to go on and go on and fight for more and more money, you know, and keep that path open, because he had business interests and a family business. But do you really want to go down that and completely destroy something that potentially also maybe isn't mine? But at what point was, okay, there was that financial threshold where if this is how much money the settlement is at the end of the day, this was going to be enough. I was going to be okay. Maybe I wasn't going to be driving, you know, a Lamborghini or living in the affluent area of town, but I knew that I could be okay on that, and I could raise my kids and I could live comfortably. And that is where the line had to be drawn. And so if we keep in mind where their limits are too, and that really made him comfortable, because I wasn't going to keep pushing on something that I knew was going to get me nowhere except just continue to cost me more money. And so knowing where his threshold was allowed him sense of some relief, which then allowed the process to go a little bit smoother. Once I was able to, you know, express that empathy and compassion, that's when we overcome a huge roadblock in our process, and we ended up going to a settlement far quicker than constantly beating a dead horse. You know, it's important to be aware of what do they want in this? What do you want in this? And how can you possibly come to a middle ground?
I think that's wonderful. I wish everybody in my mediation room would be that way. Now, they are to a certain extent. Most people are. They do try and find the negotiable areas. But you went a lot deeper with that in your use of empathy and compassion, recognizing that money was important to him. You didn't demean the fact that money was important to him. You allowed him that connection. But in your empathy and compassion, you looked for another area that maybe he would be okay giving in on, which was your passion, the children. Mm-hmm. You also brought up something interesting in what you just said, and that was, how can you co-parent if you know that your settlement has financially disadvantaged the other parent, which means that it's going to be coming up in the household where that other parent lives? The kids want things. I don't have the money. I'm so sorry. I'm on a budget. Mm-hmm. That's real life, setting up the other parent to almost feel like a failure in front of their children.
Yes. And I think it does come down to the hurt and the anger that's still attached to that, because a lot of that retributive justice plays into it. You want the other person to hurt and be and feel some pain, especially if they're the one that left the marriage. But if, let's say, if the financial piece is what is most important to you. And so, you know, typically I'm going to stereotype here for a minute, but let's say it's the male. You know, he was the breadwinner, he earned the money, and it's the financial piece for him that's the biggest trigger and the biggest hook. By putting your ex-partner in a financially difficult place, you are setting yourself up for a future of constantly being triggered by that. You are setting yourself up to be constantly having to deal with that financial piece, which is the most triggering and potentially sabotaging of the whole process. So why would you want that to keep coming back and poking you constantly on a monthly basis? You know, so make it a situation where, okay, I'm going to do this so that this isn't constantly coming back on me, because my money is important and I don't want to be hounded for it every single month, or that I didn't give enough, or that she can't afford enough, et cetera, et cetera. So having awareness, you know, I work on my clients with this as well. You can't often have awareness from that in yourself. You need someone like a coach to say, okay, have you thought about this? situation? Do you constantly want to be triggered like this for the next 10 years? Oh, no, I didn't really think of it that way. So it's having, I say to my clients too, I'm here to make that invisible visible for you, because I am not part of this process again, but I can see it with more clear eyes because I'm not being emotionally triggered by this. And my job is to just bring up options for you. Have you thought about what it could look like from this perspective?
I feel so good about divorce now after talking to you. I hope everybody else did. So beautifully said, Cindy. Everything was so beautifully said. Thank you. And I've actually picked up some tools and ways of looking at things that I will use in my mediations and when I talk to my clients, because just because of some things that you've said that are uniquely said by you.
Oh, well, thank you.
I know people are going to want to get in touch with you. So would you please give people contact information now?
Yes. So if you were to look up my practice called divorceredefined.ca, I can also be reached at my email, which is info@divorceredefined.ca. or directly at 778-837-1915.
Once again.
778-837-1915. And people can text me directly.
So I think we should tell people that you are in Vancouver, but you work not only outside of Vancouver, but in other countries. That speak English, I guess. Do you speak more than one language by any chance?
I don't.
Okay.
I don't.
So any English-speaking person, regardless of where they live, can benefit with their relationship with you. And when you're working with people in other cities, other states, other countries, do you try and vet professionals they can go to where they live?
Yes. Yes. So my network of professionals are huge all across Canada, all across the United States. The beauty of having my certification is that it is recognized by the International Coaching Federation. So I can work with anyone going through divorce anywhere in the world. Typically right now, it's been strictly Canada and the US, and I have clients back east. I have clients in the States, potentially some happening in the UK very soon. I know divorce coaching is just sort of a starting there. But really anyone who is going through divorce process, I can help support them and direct them to the right people to help them too.
I bet you can. Thank you, Cindy. Mm-hmm. This has just been a delight. I appreciate you being with us. I would like to keep the door open to talk again in the future, if I may.
I would love that. Yes, thank you so much for having me today.
My pleasure. And thank all of you for listening. You know, I appreciate each and every one of you. If you would like to get in touch with me, either for a topic idea, as a guest to interview, if you feel you would like to add to this program, I am always open. You can reach me through my website, theamicabledivorceexpert.com. theamicabledivorceexpert.com. I look forward to speaking to you next week. And as always, have an amicable day.
That's our show for today. Thank you for joining us. Be good to yourselves, be kind to your spouse, and cherish your children above all else.